Thank you very much for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to share my message with all of you. I was in IIT in the period of 89 to 93, and a paradigm shift happened in my life when I came across an experience. One of my classmates who was very good in studies, he attempted to commit suicide. And I was quite bewildered because I thought he was doing great. When I asked him, "Why did you try to commit suicide?" his reply was interesting. He said that in every exam I get the gold medal, but in this exam I got the silver medal and I could not handle it. And because of this gap between expectation and reality, I got so stressed out that I tried to kill myself. Fortunately, the rope from which he was hanging himself, it broke. So the suicide attempt failed. But then the interesting thing is, it created a paradigm within my mind that life is much more than just events, achievements, accomplishments, but a very major component of life's experiences is expectations. In the same college, in the same exam, I found four or five of my other friends who failed in four to five subjects, but they were moving around the campus blissfully, as if nothing happened, blessing others. And then when I asked them, if this guy just missed getting a gold medal and he's so frustrated, he's trying to kill himself, and you guys have failed and flunked in four or five subjects and you look perfectly peaceful, what's going on? And they said, our philosophy in life is simple. College mein ghusna apna kaam hai, nikalna college ka kaam hai. I don't endorse that philosophy. But it was a very interesting paradigm. And today, all across the world, in a globe which has 7.6 billion people on this planet, we began with 1 billion in the year 1800. We reached 2 billion in 1930. We reached 3 billion in 1960. We reached 4 billion in 1975. And then today, we are at 7.6 billion population. We have 300 million people across the world who are experiencing stress symptoms and mental health disorders. Therefore, I was at a particular point in time where I started exploring and introspecting and thinking about what should be my mission in life. And then I came across the Bhagavad Gita. And then most people think that Bhagavad Gita is just some kind of a religious book. And in fact, I was giving a talk at MIT in Boston. And after the talk, one of the professors came up to me and he said that they say that you're an engineer, but your language is different, your dress is different, your hairstyle is totally different. What are you? Are you an engineer? Are you a doctor? What are you? I said, I'm a Vedic psychiatrist. And therefore, dear friends, the Bhagavad Gita is a book which speaks about the ultimate management principle, which is managing one's own self. Because today we are living in a world where people seem to have lost control over their own self, over their own habits, over their own emotions. We are living in a world where people are trying to forget their distresses, their woes, their difficulties by consuming 8 billion cigarettes every single day, 6.75 trillion cigarettes per annum are being smoked. Every single day, 2,000 crores rupees worth of drugs is being smuggled across the borders of India. And in an education system which has 27 crore students in more than 15 lakh schools in India and 3 crore students in 56,000 colleges and universities across India, we find that every single day in India, 370 people are committing suicide. They are in a state of such distress, such sorrow, such hopelessness that they have practically losing their hope. And therefore, I decided that based on the message of the Gita, which was spoken to an extremely successful Arjuna. Arjuna had nothing but a track record of success in life. He was the best student in Dronacharya's institute. Arjuna won practically every battle. In fact, he won the battle for winning Miss Universe as his wife, Draupadi. In spite of having a string of successes on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, Arjuna experienced a moment where he had everything going for him, but just because he saw Dronacharya and Bhishma in front of him, his teacher and his grandfather, he got bewildered. And he thought, as a warrior, I must kill, but as a grandson, I must love, and as a student, I must respect. And he got confused between his identities as a warrior, as a student, and as a grandson. And this change in identities, multiple identities, created confusion for him. And this confusion resulted in his losing his confidence. And therefore, one of the most intelligent personalities at that moment, one of the most successful people, got totally paralyzed because of his inability to resolve conflicting identities. And believe me, Arjuna was in a day and age where he did not have his identity in Facebook and Twitter, any of the social media. And then Krishna spoke the Bhagavad Gita. And the Gita was spoken to a highly successful person who had the skills of a warrior, but he lost the will to fight. And therefore, I decided to dedicate my life to distribute the most important ingredient which every person needs in life, hope. H-O-P-E, hope or Aasha. Because if you have all other assets, but if you lose hope, you cannot do anything. If you have no assets available, you are extremely resource crunched. But if you have hope, if you have aspiration, if you have passion, then the sky is the limit on what can be achieved. And therefore, dear friends, India as a country has always been glorified for its culture, its tradition, and for its wisdom. And therefore, I picked up the essence of this Bhagavad Gita, and since then, last 26 years, I have been distributing this message of the Gita in various categories of people across, helping people develop hope in their lives, direction in their lives, because I realized the value of this wisdom. I was distributing the Gita in the train many years ago. I showed the Gita to one gentleman. He looked at me and he said, "Is this Bhagavad Gita for free?" I said, "No, the Gita is for 70 rupees. He looked at me and said, "Krishna spoke the Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna for free. Why are you selling it for 70 rupees? I said, "Sir, Krishna spoke to Arjuna the Gita in Kurukshetra. This is Mumbai. 70 rupees is transport charge." And therefore, it's extremely important for us to know that apart from the competence, the skills and the various commercial aspects which we are focusing in life, what we have as a strength in our nation is the soft power, the culture, the values, the ethics, the character. And if you add this dimension in people's life, it can move to another level. So therefore, many years ago, when the entire planet was going through a major crisis in terms of economic meltdown, One of the professors wrote a paper on why Indian economy is going up. The rest of the economy across the world is going down, but the Indian economy is going up, and he said it has to do something with the power of mental resilience which is there within the Indians, who know how to think out of the box and deal with the most difficult situations with fortitude and not losing hope. And he called that the Jugaad theory. And Jugaad is a non-translatable word. Only if you are Indian you can understand. I was traveling in train, and right in front of me there was a gentleman. Two gentlemen were sitting. I had a friend from New York who was with me, and the fan above our head was not functioning. This gentleman took out his hair comb and he started moving the blades of the fan. The other guy went and started switching on and off. The fan started moving. My friend from New York took out the camera and said, "I must click this. It is awesome. What is this?" I said, "This is traditional Indian technology." And so I was traveling with two of my friends from America, and we landed in Kolkata. And then we were traveling 3 hours to Kharagpur, but we came to know that it is Bengal Band that day. So when I came out, I said, "So today, no cars will move?" And they welcomed us with garlands, and the organizer said, "Yes, the program is on." I said, "But it is Bengal Band. How can we travel?" They said, "We have come to pick you up in an ambulance." And as we were entering the ambulance, this ambulance was apparently going towards Kharagpur, and they picked us up. My two friends in America were friends. This ambulance was apparently going towards Kharagpur, and they picked us up. My two friends in America were bewildered. They were asking me, "Why are we going in an ambulance?" I said, "Very difficult question to answer, because first I will explain to you what birth is." And then as we entered inside, people were stopping us, and then at one point someone said, "I want to see who's behind." I was sitting in front. My two friends, after taking breakfast with garlands around their neck, were sleeping peacefully. This guy looked inside and said, "Inki atma ko shanti mile." And within 3 hours, we made our destination. So today, one of the biggest challenges we face is we have the assets, we have the skills, we have the power. Therefore, this is the most important ingredient which we need to supply, and we need people to understand that there is no point simply conducting seminars on the art of success, because the greater reality in life is failure, and we need to help our students, our children, our family members cope with failure. And therefore, the Gita is a great book on helping you understand the art of failure. Today, people think that India is a poor country and this and that and so many things. But let me tell you, I was doing a program in America. I met one gentleman after the program. A youth came up to me, started speaking to me in Hindi. I looked at him and said, "You look like an American. You're speaking in Hindi." He said, "Yes, I'm son of a multimillionaire. I grew up with everything in life. When I was 17 years old, I told my dad, 'Dad, you gave me everything in life except what is family. Because you were divorced. And because of that, I did not experience the warmth of staying with a family, staying together, having lunch and dinner with other family members. I miss the warmth of family.' And today, across the world, country like Luxembourg has 87% of divorce rate. Spain has 65% divorce rate. France has 55% divorce rate. Russia has 51% divorce rate. USA has 46% divorce rate. The global divorce rate is 44%, but we in India have the privilege to have the lowest divorce rate in the world at 1%. So far. And then, when I looked at this gentleman, he said, "Then my father told me, 'If you really want to experience family, go to India.' He came to Varanasi, went to a family and said, 'If you allow me to stay in your family as one of your members and experience the warmth of family for 2 years, every month I'll give you a monthly rent of 1 lakh rupees just to experience what is family. The family said, why 2 years only? Spend whole life. And they said, if you have other friends who want to experience, call them also. They looked at this opportunity as family tourism. And therefore, when the British saw that the number of cobras were increasing in Delhi, during the British time in the early 1900s, they made a rule, if you can catch a dead cobra and bring, we'll give you 10 paise. They thought people will kill cobra and bring, but farmers around Delhi started rearing more cobras. And then when the Britishers realized that they made a mistake in their evaluation of India as a country, they scrapped that deal and said, you will not get that money anymore. The farmers became angry, released all the cobras in Delhi. And therefore, this concept you can still find on Google, that when the solution to a problem is worse than the initial problem, it is called as a cobra effect. And therefore, as a society, we have the privilege of having our traditional wisdom, which may be ancient, but it has the potential to resolve each and every one of our contemporary issues and problems. And so I have the privilege of the last 10 years working in rural Maharashtra in a place called Govardhan Eco Village in Wada Taluka, where we are doing rural development in more than 55 villages. And Govardhan Eco Village in 2017 won the United Nations World Tourism Organization Award for ecotourism as a catalyst for rural development. And this year we have become accredited as a United Nations Environment Program NGO. And I'm happy that in a situation where the whole planet Earth is experiencing hopelessness because of climate change, we are trying to provide a Vedic climate change adaptation model through the Govardhan Eco Village. And I'm happy that I had the opportunity in my life to study our own tradition very deeply. And because of my background in technology, I could also do something to execute something of value in rural Maharashtra. Today, with 700,000 villages across India, dear friends, we need inspiration, integrity, and intelligence to create transformation for more than 80 crore of our population who is living in very desolate conditions in rural India. And therefore, we as a country have to come forward as a family and make a resolve that just as underprivileged members of the family are taken care by the others, we have to come together, the government, the corporates, the NGOs, the willingness to support and help has to come forward, and then only we can create a transformation. And that has been my story in life, a story where I have tried to create transformation in people's life by giving them hope, the greatest asset. Thank you.